Hello and welcome to Arcanine Rides. Today we're getting back to the basics in the first of a series of videos I like to call Scootering for Dummies. I want to cover the basics of electric scooters so that people getting into the hobby can have somewhere to start. You might also pick up a thing or two even if you've been riding for a while. This video will be looking at the different types of electric scooters because there's quite a bit of variety. If you're in the market for a scooter, then this is a great place to start. Let's start with what many would call entry-level scooters. Most of these scooters are priced under $600 or $700, with the most popular scooters at this level costing $300 to $400. Lots of brands have a scooter at this price point, but the best-selling brands are Segway and GoTrax. These are the scooters that you would find as the best-selling scooters on Amazon and on the shelves at your local big box stores. These entry-level scooters are great for dipping your toes into riding electric scooters without having to commit a large amount of money. However, I would actually say that these are not necessarily the best option for someone looking at getting their first scooter. I'll elaborate on that in a second, but first let's look at the main features of this category of scooter. These scooters are single motor scooters with a top speed of 20 miles per hour or less. They tend to advertise a range of 10 to 20 miles, but the reality is that almost none of these scooters will get that kind of range. You'll notice this as a trend for almost all electric scooters, that the advertised range is about double what a realistic range for the scooter is. Many scooters have a riding mode designed to conserve battery while sacrificing speed. These eco modes will get you closer to the advertised range, but they cut speed so severely that hardly anyone is regularly riding in these modes. The entry-level scooters are also typically quite light and compact. These scooters can weigh under 30 pounds, making them really easy to carry around in store. The smaller size also means that they have annoyingly small riding platforms or super low handlebar height, so keep that in mind if you're taller or have large feet. These scooters don't usually have many moving parts and are just made of a couple main sections, so they can be quite sturdy if the folding mechanism is decent enough. One of the biggest issues with these entry-level scooters is how poorly they perform on any type of hill. The low power, single motor setup means that you're almost better walking these scooters than using them up any sort of extended incline. You'll also find that if you get one of these scooters, you'll crave more speed very quickly. 15 to 20 miles per hour is great speed for that last mile on your commute, but if you're buying a scooter strictly for recreational purposes and aren't on a super tight budget, then you probably want to avoid this category of scooters. Take it from me, who upgraded to a faster scooter after less than a month of owning my first entry-level scooter. Or take it from the dozens of people who comment on my videos or email me that they want to upgrade to something faster after just a couple of weeks. You'll actually save money in the long run by skipping this category of scooter and getting something with more oomph and long-term quality for a couple hundred more dollars. However, if you're in the market for a scooter strictly for commuting, don't have a long commute, and have a tight budget, then this is a good way to go. A red flag to keep an eye out for when shopping for entry-level scooters is air-filled or pneumatic tires. Companies will advertise this as a big bonus and talk about how it improves ride comfort and blah blah blah, but it's a trap. If you're buying an entry-level scooter, I would always recommend solid tires. Air-filled offers very little in terms of increased ride comfort on a scooter that's only going 15 or 20 miles an hour max, while posing a huge issue if you get a flat. Companies don't care about making these scooters easy to maintain or easy to find parts for, so fixing something as simple as a flat tire on these scooters can be an enormous time-consuming headache. Higher-end scooters have split hubs that allow easy access to the tube and tires, making swapping a flat tube much easier. These lower-end scooters will not have a split hub like this and will generally not be designed to have their hub pulled off of the scooter. I quite literally had to break my $400 Hover One Alpha to get the back hub motor off of the scooter, and even with two people, I was unable to successfully remove the tire and tube even while using tire levers. Many people have to find out the hard way how stupidly annoying it can be to fix a flat tire on a scooter like this, so don't be one of those people. Stick to an entry-level scooter with solid tires if you're going to get an entry-level scooter. I've already reviewed the popular Amazon scooter, the HiBoy S2 Pro, so check that video out if you're in the market for a scooter in this category. I plan to get a hold of and review as many more of these Amazon entry-level scooters as I can over the coming year, so be sure to get subscribed to see those reviews. For the next categories of scooters, they won't be divided super strictly by price, but instead I've broken them down by their use case. So the next category is the commuting-focused street scooters. These scooters can be single or dual motor, and rather than focusing on super high speed and performance, these scooters are capable of really good range and hill climbing while still being fairly portable and comfortable to ride. You're looking at spending anywhere from $900 and up for this style of scooter depending on your preferences. Many of these scooters have solid tires to avoid flat tires and keep scooter maintenance to a minimum. Many do not have any form of suspension, and the ones that do usually have minimal suspension since this style of scooter is designed for street riding only. Most scooters in this category weigh less than 40 or 50 pounds, making them reasonable to carry around while still having the battery size, features, and performance you'd expect for their price. Scooters in this category can be folded down small enough to fit in the trunk of almost any car and can easily be stored under a desk at work or school or in the corner without taking up a lot of room. The single motor scooters in this category typically have the best range, getting at least 20 miles of range on a single charge. Speed is typically a weaker point of these single motor long range commuters with speeds around 20 to 25 miles an hour. They come with larger motors that do make them capable of reasonable speeds uphill. The most well-known and popular scooter in this category is the Ninebot Max. It's on the low end price-wise, while still offering really great range. The eMove Cruiser is a single motor scooter notorious for its extremely long range and all-weather riding capabilities. Another option in the commuter category is going for something dual motor. I did say that the focus of these scooters isn't necessarily performance, but the dual motor scooters in this category can pack quite a bit of power and speed into a small package. That does mean sacrificing range, but in returns, you can get speeds of 30 miles an hour or faster and great hill climbing capabilities. My two biggest recommendations in this category for dual motor scooters are the Varla Pegasus and the Cabo Mantis 8. Both have a minimum of 15 miles of range and top speeds of over 30 miles an hour. The Pegasus has more top end speed and solid tires, while the Mantis 8 has slightly better range and folds down more compactly. Check out my video comparing these two scooters down below in the description. Most people will find that this commuter category fits their needs while fitting into a reasonable budget. Whether you need a quick, reliable scooter for getting to work or school, or a compact, affordable, dual-motor scooter for zipping around your local neighborhood, this category has it all. But now let's step up a little bit in price and look at some bigger scooters for those that want something fast and capable. Let's start with what I like to call the big suspension category. These are higher-end scooters with great road speed, but also capabilities to ride off-road and on all-terrain without issue. These scooters start around $1,500 and have a minimum of 10-inch pneumatic tires. They're capable of speeds of over 35 miles an hour and have substantial enough suspension to handle dirt roads and large rocks. They either ship with off-road tires or have them readily available to be swapped out. They also tend to have decent IP ratings so that they can ride through water, dirt, and mud without having issues. The Varla Eagle 1 is one of the least expensive off-road capable scooters on the market while also boasting a great top speed of almost 40 miles an hour. I've ridden this scooter a ton over the past year and a half and have put lots of off-road miles on it. The Kiawa Q-Power 2 is a monster of an off-road scooter with better off-road capabilities than any other scooter I've ridden. It does cost about $1,000 more than the Eagle 1 though. Options like the Cabo Wolf Warrior and other high-speed dual-stanchion scooters make great off-road options, though they often come at very premium prices. And speaking of premium prices, let's look at our last category, the high-speed street scooter category. These are scooters that go over 35 miles an hour with a more street-focused ride and design. These are the scooters to start to look at when you feel very comfortable riding at higher speeds, but aren't limited by a super tight budget. These scooters can cost as low as $1,500, but high quality scooters in this category usually sit around $2,000 or more. Some of the most well-known and well-liked scooters in this category are the Wolf King and Mantis Pro from Cabo, the VSET 10 Plus, and almost the entire line of Dualtron scooters. This category also contains what could be called hyper scooters. Hyper scooters are scooters that achieve ridiculous levels of speed, typically at prices above $3,000 or $4,000, and sometimes even $5,000, $6,000, $7,000, $8,000. Companies like Rion and WePed specialize in insanely fast road scooters capable of speeds over 70 miles an hour. And there you have it. There are lots of scooters out on the market, and some may fit into multiple of these categories or in between these categories, but generally, I feel like electric scooters fit into one of these four categories. I hope this helps you better understand the scooter market and helps you make a decision on what type of scooter is right for you. Leave any questions you have below in the comments and get subscribed for the continuation of this Scootering for Dummies series and for more electric scooter content. See you in the next video.